another letter has arrived for you, Miss March.
Mrs. Kirk, the mutton you ordered is on the kitchen table. Thank you, Professor. Christopher Columbus, another publisher! Another rejection.
I have no idea. I do not read your letters, but they keep arriving and I keep bringing them to you.
And I keep hoping.
We all keep hoping for your success, Miss March. The entire boarding house keeps on hoping. You have us all on edge.
My dear Miss March, I've read your story. Well, he's read it! Unfortunately, I found your tale tasteless and vulgar. Not at all suitable for my readers.
My advice to you is to return home and have babies. This is what women are made for. Sincerely, F. Putnam.
22 rejections as I've been in New York. They all say the same thing. Go home. Give up.
You cannot lose faith, Miss March. There will be someone who will like your story. I'm certain of it.
Professor Bayer, is it possible I could read my story to you? I would so respect your opinion.
Yes, of course.
Actually, it's one of my best. It's a mean and stormy night. The moors are bleak and bloody. Thunder claps. Lightning strikes. The fair Clarissa, her clothes in disarray, races across the wild coastal heath. Now she stops. Now she runs. Will she escape? Will she be caught? With bold determination, the villainous aristocrat, Braxton Prendergast, lurches for her! There's no escape. She's but a child, and yet she turns to fight with eyes ablaze. This noble girl meets his gaze unafraid. She will not be defiled. Keep away from me, you wretch! Ignites me!
Try not to forget. I think you could do better.
Better? And who are you, anyway? An aging German professor?
I worry a lot.
And just what do you worry about?
How to avoid conversations such as this. Miss March, since you arrived here, you upset the whole order of the boarding house. I am a serene and peaceful man.
You're aloof. You're arrogant.
Arrogant? I spoke my mind as you spoke yours. Obviously, it wasn't appreciated on either side.
Obviously! My stories were a great success in Concord. Better than what? Better than this dazzling plot. Better, the story will be my King Lear. Each phrase is better than him. Better, even my smallest whim is better. Don't succeed, what will I do? Turn around, go back to Concord. Leave New York behind unconquered. No! How dare he make me doubt the way I feel? Doubt that each thrilling page is who I am.
My dress was ragged and my nose was... governess. I should be meeting eligible young men.
It's going to be a dismal Christmas, but with Father away and no money for presents.
Meg, Amy, Joe has a surprise for us.
I have risen to the occasion this year and written us an operatic tragedy.
And we are going to perform it for Christmas.
No, I can't. Not with my flat nose.
Joe, do you really think we should? What with this awful war?
When have we let anything defeat us? Years from now, people will talk about us. One Christmas Eve, four penniless and ragged sisters put on an operatic tragedy for all of Concord.
Oh,
all of
Concord, no.
Filled with blood and guts. Two massacres, a masked ball, and several heart-wrenching scenes. We'll dim the lights, the crowd will hush. We'll start the overture and Beth will surely blush. For when Clarissa starts to plead, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams.
Joe, do I die again in this one?
Yes, Maggie will die like none before. The world will shudder when your body hits the floor. For when Rodrigo makes you bleed, Christmas will exceed our finest dreams. Now Amy, as Clarissa, only passion is permissible. The tragedy depends upon the fire in your eyes. And back when you're the mother, from the heart. Mother, oh no, dear mother, do not cry.
Mother, oh no, dear mother. Joe, I am teased and ridiculed at school and all the concerns of your silly little tragedy.
I know you're tired, I know it's hard, but we will triumph when Rodrigo yells on guard.
Touché!
Success is guaranteed. Christmas will be thrilling. Christmas will be gory. Christmas will exceed our finest dreams. I made an important decision today. As you all know, I've been writing stories forever with much satisfaction. And people seem to like what I write.
Oh, we love it, Joe.
Absolutely. So, I've decided I'm going to become a world-renowned writer. I shall write great books and earn barrels of money. And I'll give you all everything you've ever dreamed of.
Joe, to do anything.
But we must promise to remain just as we are. Solid, like a fortress. No matter whatever happens, we must promise that it will always be the Four March Sisters. Forever?
Forever!
Come, let's begin.
Mother! Mother, do not mind telling
you! You will have me or no one!
Come on!
Tonight. Another.
I want you to get Annie Moffat to invite me to her St. Valentine's Day ball.
Oh, I'll wring her bloody little neck if she doesn't. Another.
I want you to get us a Christmas tree.
Rodrigo will go chop one down immediately.
Where?
There, across the road.
But that's on Mr. Lawrence's property.
You'll go to prison for it.
Prison? What care I for prison?
Joe is an incredible human being. Look, it's Mr. Lawrence. He's standing there at the window glaring out.
He looks sinister.
I think he looks sad. They say he's a very angry and bitter old man. Joe's going to get us all into deathly trouble.
He'll be known as the family with the criminal sister.
What criminal sister?
Marnie!
My gracious girls,
I'm so glad you've returned.
Marnie, I'm so excited to see you.
Joe's written an operatic tragedy.
And she's inviting all of Concord to come see us perform it.
And I'm the mother in it.
And I die in it.
But it's a beautiful death.
And I play Clarissa, who's very sweet.
It sounds wonderful.
Oh, Marmee, it's Joe's best.
Tell us about your day.
Well, we knitted socks and blankets for the Soldiers' Aid Society. And a letter came from Father.
A letter from Father!
And it's yours, Marmee!
Where's Joe?
She's outside?
Rodrigo has returned!
Joe?
Marmee!
Where did you get that tree?
I borrowed it from Mr. Lawrence.
Joe, you didn't.
I took it for us, Marmee.
You'll take it back immediately.
Take it back? That's like taking back a chicken after you've chopped off its head. Do let us keep it.
It's Christmas, Marmee.
Well, we could give it to the Hummels. They have so little.
Good. The tree goes to the Hummels then. Now, what about Mr. Lawrence?
What about him?
Mr. Lawrence?
Yes, Mr. Lawrence. You chopped down my perfect Douglas fir. I should have you arrested.
I'll make it up to you, sir. I'll plant 6 more.
12.
And I'll chop your firewood for a few days?
Weeks. And I hope such an incident never happens again. You've ruined my day.
Loves his trees. I'm Theodore Lawrence III, but everyone calls me Laurie. I've come to live here in Concord. I play the piccolo. I can sleep standing up. Once I won a medal at school for holding my breath for nearly 3 minutes before passing out. I thought it was terrifically daring of you chopping down grandfather's tree. Well, good night.
Theodore Lawrence III, would you mind delivering this tree to the Hummels?
Joe?
I don't mind at all.
He doesn't mind. They live half a mile down the road, the red house with the broken shingles.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas!
Joe, you must think before you act on every whim.
I just wanted us all to have a wonderful Christmas.
A letter's come from Father.
Christopher Columbus!
Do read the letter, Marmee.
My dear wife, the war goes on and on. The end seems nowhere in sight. The days are difficult and long. But I am well.
He's well.
Each night in my tent, I think of my precious girls.
He thinks of us.
Shh. Give them all my love. Tell them to be good girls and to conquer that which is disagreeable in them. So that when I return, I'll be fonder and prouder than ever of my little women.
Why are we all looking so glum? Do we have an operatic tragedy to perform or not?
We do.
Then we have work to do.
Will you perform something, Marmee?
Do, Marmee.
And I'll write something thrilling for you with passion and daring.
Yes, yes. We'll make it the best Christmas ever. We marchmen are invincible.
Come, let's get to work.
Mother,
not
to
my God, you do not run!
My dear husband.
and your work day begins with me at 9. You've missed reading to me.
I got delayed. Finding you this beautiful flower.
Don't trifle with me, Josephine. You were dawdling.
I wasn't dawdling. I was writing a story.
You are what happens to a girl when she has no father.
I have a father.
Never here when you need him. Josephine, listen to me. You are on the verge of womanhood.
Christopher Columbus.
And just look at yourself. You go about writing these senseless stories. There are many pitfalls a girl can fall into, and Josephine, you are heading towards all of them. I want to see you shine. Even if you're not rich, you can at least marry well.
I'll never marry.
You'll marry. All girls marry.
I'm not all girls.
With a good marriage, you can have power. You can take your place in society.
I give two figs about society.
Well, then I suppose there is no point in our having this conversation. It's clear to me I could never take you to Europe.
Take me to Europe?
It was an idle thought of mine.
Do you know how important it is for a writer to travel? It's been my dream, Aunt March.
We earn our dreams in this world, Josephine. It's foolish of me to think that you could ever change your ways.
I could try.
You could never bend your will. You could never follow through. You could never bite your tongue, though your tongue may spit in two. If you want to live your dreams, these are things you have to do. How could you change? You can't, not you.
I could change if I wanted to.
Could you practice self-control? Could you possibly be shy? Could you wear a corset tight in the heat of mid-July? These are rules you must obey, everyone which you defy. You'll never change. You won't, that's why. Yet somewhere deep within my heart I do believe you could captivate the world. If you could change, there is so much you could achieve. In time you could succeed and travel. Beguiling,
charming me,
someone well-mannered, a model of grace. Learn the art of smiling.
That could be hard.
It isn't very hard for someone full of dreams like you. If you work, you'll find there's nothing you can't do.
So if I change, we'll go to Paris.
Change completely or don't waste my time.
If I change, we'll stop at Antwerp.
Gracious living will make you sublime.
If I change, you'll take me to Zurich.
Every city from Dublin to Cork.
Surely with your guidance, I could learn to use vanity. Charm a donkey for a chance to see the world. Learn the art of smiling. I could button up my mind and keep my thoughts perfumed in pearls. Yes, I surely think I could.
If you could, that would be good.
There's nothing that I wouldn't suffer to see the world. These are things a girl must do when she has dreams she must fulfill.
Change how you walk and how you talk, change how you think and how you are.
I'll hold my breath and hold my tongue, do what it takes to travel far.
them, Marmee.
Oh, to think my two eldest girls are attending their first ball. Next year, it'll be you,
Beth.
Me? You think so?
Meg, I can't go.
Meg, why not? Look at me. Every girl in Concord my age has been to a ball. And this is the very first time I've even worn a dress like this. Anything like this.
I wore that very same dress to my first ball. That didn't look half so good on me. Margaret March, you've been dreaming of Annie Moffat's St. Valentine's Day ball for months. You can't walk away from it now.
Thank you, Marmee. I appreciate it.
I am not built for gowns.
You look very alluring.
I think the word is alarming, Marmee.
What will I do when someone asks me to dance?
Just smile and say, I'd be delighted.
So glad we were invited.
Completely delighted. Who paid the coachman?
I did.
Delighted, provided success has been decided.
Which one is your choice?
You said, and when Joe comes home, you can apologize. All right, let's get ready for bed. Oh, come on, Beth. Amy?
Coming!
Thank you.
Joe.
It was an accident. But swear, Meg, Miss Parrot kept moving in on me like a mountain lion. She kept shouting at me,
"What's Becky say, my dear?"
She's deaf.
She got so close to me, I ended up spilling the entire glass of punch on her.
Oh, Joe.
And then Annie Moffat said to me,
"Can I be of help, Sally?"
Sally? Who's Sally?
I think it's her dog.
Now I gotta box her ears.
Joe, don't. We'll take a few minutes, then go back in as if nothing had happened. Our heads held high.
Yes, you're right. For a young lady who is soon to go abroad and do amazing things, I shall return poised and elegant. I shall sit grandly. Oh, Christopher Columbus!
Excuse me.
You.
Me.
What are you doing here?
I passed out. Too much dancing, I guess.
Too much punch, I'd say.
Lori, where have you been? I've been looking everywhere for you.
Mr. Brooke, I want to...
Your grandfather would be furious. He wants you to meet some important people.
I have. These are the March girls I've been telling you about. This is... Meg. Right?
Yes.
And this is Jo March. She cuts her firewood on occasions. This is Mr. John Brooke, a scholar from Boston.
I'm Lori's tutor. Come, Lori.
Sir, you've taken my dance card.
Your dance card? Oh, is this yours? Sorry. So, you're Margaret March.
Yes, I am.
It's a splendid party, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Quite lovely. So, you're from Boston.
Actually, Maine.
I've never been to Maine.
You should go. It's a beautiful country. Very primitive.
I like primitive.
You do?
Mr. Brooke is a romantic.
Is that true?
Oh, no, no. I read Sheets and Kelly. I mean Keats and Shelley.
So do I.
You read Keats and Shelley?
All the time.
Christopher Columbus.
Would you like to dance, Miss March?
Meg. We were just about to join the ladies at the salon.
I'd be delighted, Mr. Brooke. Excuse us, Joe.
Did you just see that? He just... What is it with you and that smile?
You make me beam.
You look ridiculous.
You look very fetching tonight.
Fetching? Really?
So, when you're not attending balls, what do you do?
I write blood and gut stuff. I make extraordinary plans. What about you? What do you do? Mommy says you're all alone in the world. No mother or father. It must be awful for you.
It's not awful. I've got a cranky old grandfather. And I've got my cat. And I've got...
What?
I was hoping to say you.
Me? You don't have me.
I know I have no right. But sometimes late at night, I watch you in that attic, pacing back and forth like a maniac. I've never met a girl like you, anyone at all like you. This is very nice. Such a lovely party. The music sounds so thrilling. It makes a person feel like dancing. I'm very good. I won a medal for dancing at school.
I don't dance. Besides, I've got a patch on the back of my dress.
A patch? Let me see.
No!
I like it. That patch could start a whole new fashion. You dance with me tonight, and I guarantee by next spring, every girl in Concord will be wearing a patch on her dress. We could do 100 things, do anything you please. We could fly on golden wings across the seven seas. I'll bet we could get a camel through a needle if you'll take a chance on me.
You are a lunatic.
We could catch 1,000 stars and stand them on a pin. We could leap from here to Mars and make the planet spin. If you want to do all the things you ever dreamed of, come on, take a chance on me. We could be such friends. Friends are never lonely. All I know is books. Books are solitary, but I see you every day. How you live in your own way.
All right. We can box if you like.
You box?
You ready?
I should warn you. I won a medal for boxing at school. Cheat. We could live a million dreams, but only if we dare.
You win!
We could go to such extremes, there's so much we could share. We'll circle the world doing all we ever dreamed of. And we'll live in our own way, and I'll see you every day. We'll be the best of on me.
So, what do you say? Try me?
I challenge you to a skating race tomorrow at the pond. Come on!
Dancing in. The ankle may be sprained. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
The evening began very strangely, but ending magnificently. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Can you walk on it?
It's nothing, Marmee. Tell us about the ball.
Oh, I tried to do all these ladylike things, Marmee. But poor Meg. No one even asked to dance with her except that pompous Mr. Brooke.
He danced divinely. I had a wonderful time. Actually, I had the best time of my life. I may have left here a girl, but I came home a woman. Oh, what is she talking about, Meg?
It's just Meg being silly, Marmee.
A girl's off to bed. It's been a long day for us all.
I'm just going to put the finishing touches on my story, Marmee.
Don't be too long. And see that the fire is out?
Amy, where are you?
Amy! Joel,
what happened?
Amy, what did you do with my story?
Nothing, I...
What did you do? I was working on that story day and night!
I burned it!
You what?
And I'm glad I did.
Amy!
I'm gonna choke you!
Joel, no!
Go on and bare my throat to you!
Girl, stop it! Back to bed now! What has got into you both?
She burned my story!
Amy, what did you do?
She deserved it!
Joe? No, Amy, she did not deserve it. You did an intolerable thing. You destroyed what meant the world to Joe.
Joe has everything!
What do I have? I wear dresses with patches! I write a story that my sister burned!
You could have given me the invitation!
The invitation was meant for me!
Your time will come.
No, my time will never come! I'm always forgotten, I'm always last! I have nothing special!
That's enough! Both of you look at me! I can't demand you two love one another, but I do demand that you live together with respect.
I hate the way I look! I hate this nightgown!
It was mine!
I'll take back that fan.
I'm so sorry. It's not your fault. Well, you did give birth to her. Can't you see she wants to be like you? She's just a child, Joe.
She's not just a child. She's a demon in a child's body.
Joe.
Writing is everything to me, Marmy. It's who I am. It's my future. It's my passion.
That passion is still inside of you. Believe me, Joe, it's still there.
I'll never forgive her.
You're not wrong, Joe, to feel anger.
But if you build a wall between you and Amy, the one person you may end up hurting is yourself. And I couldn't bear that. Try and get some rest. I can't sleep. I won't.
I will never fall asleep again. Not for decades, no.
Not even then.
My life was in this story. How could she be so cruel? How can so much be lost so easily? I wrote my heart out, it does not seem fair. I'll rage until I'm withered. I'll grow cold and bitter.
Grandson Laurie.
I'm sure he'll be home soon.
So, which one of the dreadful little March girls are you?
I'm Dreadful Beth.
Yes, Laurie's told me about you. You're the one who wants to play with my priceless piano. It's out of the question that the piano belonged to my daughter, Laurie's mother. And it's been locked ever since she passed away, and that's how it shall stay. Are you afraid of me?
A little.
Why?
It might have something to do with your face, sir. It's very hard.
Could not help my hard face. Continue what you were playing. Go on now. I haven't had all day. Are you going What's the matter now?
I don't remember the rest, sir.
Why we wait to a poker for the folk along the parapets?
Off
to Massachusetts.
Yes, we're off.
To where the shops are sweet.
We will play minuets on the Massachusetts.
Boston, Massachusetts, Beacon Street. If you say, come with me, off to Massachusetts.
Then to Massachusetts we will go.
Buy the finest china, then we'll dine
a while the grapes you get.
Off to Massachusetts,
yes, we're off.
To where the shops are sweet.
We will have no regrets, off to Massachusetts.
Boston, Massachusetts, we.
Boston, Massachusetts, we.
Boston, Massachusetts, we repeat. To that old piano and see if there's any music left in it. Will you come?
Yes.
Good. And if you see Laurie, tell him I wish to see him at once.
Meg!
What is it, Beth?
Mr. Lawrence was here and he invited me to come to his house and play his piano.
Oh, Beth!
You know, he's really not as horrible as we all imagined.
Meg, Beth!
What happened?
She fell through the ice.
She was skating by the bridge. Then the ice gave way. I got to her just in time.
She's careless. She's rash.
She just wanted to be with you. Here.
I'm skating so beautifully.
You don't think. You know you're not supposed to skate by the bridge. Everyone knows the ice by the bridge is dangerous.
If it weren't for Laurie, you could have been killed.
Maybe it would have been better if I had.
You must never talk like that. When the ice broke underneath you, all I could think was I could have lost you.
Go on, Joe. Forgive her.
See how much she's changed.
See her sweet
side. I think
side.
She deserves
Everybody
a second
stop
chance.
Stop it!
I was devastated when you burned my story. I didn't understand how you could do such a thing. Promise me. Promise me you'll never think of me as an enemy. A sister who loves you.
I promise, Jill. The March sisters forever.
Forever!
Forever!
Laurie. Laurie, who saved Amy and made this day possible. I want to declare before everyone, before the world, that on this day of forgiveness and joy, that you, Theodore Lawrence the Third, who has valiantly lost all contests to me. I declare you our brother. The brother we never had.
Really?
Come on!
Washington. I'll check in on the girls every day.
Thank you,
Mr. Lawrence.
Let me just take that to the carriage. Good morning, Beth.
Morning, sir. I fixed you a basket of food. Thank you, Beth.
Amy's almost ready. She's packed up half the house.
Where's Joe? I sent her to Aunt Marge's hours ago. She should be back by now.
I'll go find her.
Here's the shawl Father loves so much.
Thank you.
Mommy, please don't make me go to Aunt Marge's house. It scares me. Everything is so old in it. I drew this picture of you. It's for Father. Is he going to die?
No, Amy. I'll see to it that he recovers.
Marmy,
I'm so sorry. I did get the money, though. Thank you, Joe. I know how hard it is for you to ask Aunt Marge.
I didn't ask Aunt Marge. I couldn't. So, I walked to the town common and stood there all day trying to sell my stories. When that didn't work, I sold my hair.
Oh, my.
You're bald.
I'm not bald.
But your hair was your best feature.
She looks beautiful.
Now Marmy will have money enough to get to Washington and stay with Father for as long as he needs her. Here, $27.25. I threw in a few coins I had stashed away. You didn't have to do this, Joe. I'm so...
disappointed.
Proud. It was a very courageous thing to do. Thank you, Joe. You look beautiful.
Thank you.
The carriage is ready, Miss March. Joe, you look different. Goodbye, Summer, I guarantee that every girl in Concord.
Don't worry. Come, let me hold my girls.
I'll look after everything, Marmy. Don't worry.
My dear Margaret, make
certain your husband recovers.
Yes, Aunt March.
And thank you so much for taking Amy.
Amy, come tell Aunt March how excited you are.
I'm so excited about living with you while Marmy's in Washington.
Naturally. No glum faces, and no tears either. I'll be back as soon as possible. How did you all grow up so fast? Goodbye, Aunt March.
And tell Father how much I miss him and love him!
Ahem.
Marmy can have a safe journey to Washington.
You did what? I told you, if you ever need money, you come to me.
I was hoping to earn my own money.
Cutting one's hair and selling it like a beggar is not an option for a lady. Have you forgotten our contract?
Oh, I never forget it. Traveling, seeing Europe, Paris, London.
You don't live up to your part of the bargain. Why should I live up to mine?
I've tried to live up to my part of the bargain. I improved my manners. I read books on etiquette. I held my tongue in several situations when I wanted to scream out. I've got a fire in me, Aunt March.
Well, just see how far this fire takes you in life. See what doors this fire will open. See what society thinks of your
life. What the hell with society?
Josephine.
We don't live for society. We live to expand our minds, fulfill our dreams, engage in passionate exchanges.
That's enough! You think you know everything, and you know nothing. As for Europe, you can forget about it. Europe is meant for someone with a little more understanding of its rewards.
Aunt March, please.
The subject is closed.
The subject is not closed. I'll go to Europe. I will. I'll go to Europe. I have to swim there.
Boo! And who is this man?
He's Laurie's tutor and a friend.
Well, tell your friend to make his visit brief. Amy, come with me. I have plans for you.
Yes, ma'am.
John, what have you done?
I've enlisted. I couldn't stand by any longer. Your own father's in the Army Hospital in Washington. I have friends who will never return.
When do you leave?
Tonight. Meg? Margaret? I'm not a rich man. And I'm not particularly handsome.
You're very handsome, John.
Really? You think so? I'm not the wisest man in the world.
You're very wise.
Thank you. Meg. Margaret.
If you could find it in your heart, if you could love me as I love you, if only you'd care while we are apart, then I would be rich, I would be wise, I would be more, more than I am.
Wait for your return, wait while you're at war.
If you could wait while I'm gone, if you'd imagine me here, if only you care if I carry on, then I could be strong.
Why must you go?
I could be brave.
Don't be too brave.
I could be
only come home
more than I am. If you will say you love me enough to marry me, I will come home and love you.
So you'll come home.
Someday, Joe. I know you will. You can do anything. You can make the clouds disappear.
It's you who makes the clouds disappear.
Come, walk with me and tell me about your day.
Well, I sold my hair.
Yes.
Then I stood at the town common. When no one paid attention to me, I cried out, Joe March is here. And then I recited my story. Carlotta, the mad woman in the attic.
Creature of gall, a spinster, rejected by the world, hungry for blood, rose from the dark. Joe March, it's your best friend, Theodore Lawrence III. Her fingers clutched with rage as she went out into the wretched night.
Lori? Lori!
Christopher Columbus, it's so good to see you. You've not been here in weeks.
I was in Boston. I have dreadful news.
What news?
I'm going to college in time for the summer session.
That's wonderful news.
What's wonderful about it? Leaving the best friend I ever had? I don't want to go.
You've got to go. This is an incredible opportunity. College? I'd go in a minute. I'd study everything.
What do you need of schools? You're going to be a famous writer.
Famous.
I need to tell you something.
Tell me something.
Ever since the first day I saw you, the day you chopped down Grandfather's cherished tree, from that day, I knew that you and I would be magnificent together.
We are magnificent together!
For weeks now, months even, this whole year actually, I've wanted to...
What was that?
A kiss!
I know it was a kiss.
It was my first kiss. I thought about it a long time.
What's gotten into you?
Look, here. I took part of my inheritance and I bought you this ring.
A ring? What are you talking about?
I want to marry you.
Marry me? Stop this
practicing
acting, it's not funny.
I've already said the words over and over again. Marry me. Marry me.
Have you gone mad?
I love you, Joe. And I want you to be my wife.
Find someone else. Find some accomplished girl.
I don't want an accomplished girl. I want you.
Well, you can't have me.
Please, say you'll think about it.
There's nothing to think about. I'll never marry.
You don't mean that.
I do mean it.
You'll marry?
I won't.
You will. Just not me. That's what you're really saying.
Go
you'll
away,
find
Mary.
Someone.
You understand nothing.
You knew all along how I felt. Everyone knew.
You knew all along who I am. What I want. I bared my soul to you, Lori. Go away.
Joe.
Please. Just go. Who was he with his marry me? With his ring and his marry me? The nerve, the gall. This is not what was meant to be. How could he ruin it all with those two words? I thought I knew him, but that he knew me. When did it change? What did I miss? A kiss when I thought all along that we were to forge frontiers. How could I be so wrong? I need my sisters here. If I can't share my dreams, what were they for? I thought our promise meant that we would never change and never part. I thought together we'd amaze the world. How can I live my dreams or even start when everything has come?
Find it, find. Miss March! Professor, have you seen the whereabouts of Miss March?
No, Miss Kirk, I have not seen the whereabouts of Miss March. What is it, Miss Kirk?
Miss March received a telegram. A telegram, Professor. She may have inherited a great deal of money. She could be an heiress. Then again, it could be a terrible tragedy. There is no telling, is there? Ask her, good friend. I think you'd be concerned for her.
We are not good friends. We are simply acquaintances.
I see. Miss March!
You and the others in the house are under the impression that Miss March and I have some sort of kinship. We have simply gone places together.
The theater?
Yes, I've taken her to see Hamlet, and I've given her 3 German lessons.
3? That many?
And I've taken her to lectures and to the park to hear speakers. But she hardly seems to know I exist. She's preoccupied. She rushes past me like wind.
Christopher Columbus! Mrs. Kirk, have you seen the professor?
Behind you, darling!
Guten Tag.
Guten Tag, Miss March. The word is Tag. Guten Tag means good day.
I know what it means, but when you taught it to me, you said Guten Tag.
I would never say Tag.
Well, I'm sure you did.
Well, I'm sure I didn't.
All right, then. Guten Tag. And it is a very Guten Tag, Professor. A wonderful Guten Tag. And I have some amazing news. I came to New York on a dream. I knew it might take me a while, but all I've been hearing since I've arrived is leave it right there on the pile. So today I woke up and decided it's time. Time to achieve, time to thrive, time to climb.
Miss March, tell us what happened.
Sometimes when you dream, your dream is just a guess. Sometimes when you work really hard, you don't know if you'll ever find success. So I grabbed a story to sell, got ready to raise hell. Then I marched out the door and headed right for the Weekly Volcano Press.
Ah, Henry Dashwood now, he's a man of taste.
Dashwood was a fiend. He sneered at my distress. Tossed my story high on a stack, but I was determined I would progress. I said, sir, always while you read. But alas, he disagreed. So I jumped on a chair and read it right there at the Weekly Volcano Press.
You did what?
Keep away from me, you wretch! I cannot give away. Your beauty draws me. Your passion ignites me!
So with all the horror in it and the bloodbath.
That's the one. It taught what you said, Professor. I embellished. I made it better. Lightning strikes. Thunder collapse. I got to have you. I defy you.
Let me buy you. Let go.
Rodrigo appears in magnificent splendor.
Unhand that woman.
Oh,
The path is perilous. She avoids swamps. She loses her footing. Her shoes tumble off. The sleeve of her dress gets caught on a twisted limb. She comes to a wild rapids and can go no further. How shall I get across? A troll appears.
If you want to cross, you must pay me.
We should celebrate your success, Miss March. Have you ever been to Broadway Gardens?
Are you asking me on a date, Professor?
No. Yes.
I should like that. Miss March, I almost forgotten all the excitement. This telegram came for you. More good news, I suspect. Christopher Columbus, today I could start a revolution. I could...
What is it, Miss March?
Is it not good news?
Dear God, no. My sister Beth has contracted scarlet fever. She's gravely ill. I must go to her immediately.
I'm sorry, dear. Sorry for you and your family.
Is there anything we could do?
No, thank you, Professor. Mrs. Kirk, tell your girls.
They'll be fine.
Tell them to keep reading.
They will.
Thank you, both, for everything.
Miss March, you will be back?
Of course I will.
And Miss March, viel Glück.
Yes. Need good luck.
Your sinful acquaintance is leaving you, Professor.
Yes.
There. That's it.
Yes.
At last, it's found a home.
It's magnificent. But Mr. Lawrence, you shouldn't have.
But I did, and enough is said on the matter.
Joe!
She's ready!
It's in place.
Meg!
Where are you taking me?
You'll see.
Is it Amy? Is she back?
It's not Amy. She's not back.
Well, what is it?
Patience.
There.
Mr. Lawrence?
Over there.
Your piano?
No, Beth. Yours.
Mine? Nor me, no.
There was no arguing with him.
But why, sir?
It kept calling to me, where's that dreadful little March girl? It missed you.
Go sit at it, Beth.
Thank you, Mr. Lawrence. I shall treasure it.
Come, play something for us now.
March, may I join you?
It'd be an honor, sir.
If you say, come with me off to Massachusetts, then to Massachusetts we will go.
We will buy dishes there, maybe even two sets.
Buy the finest china, then we'll dine a while on crepes and zets.
Massachusetts, yes, we're warm, to where the shops are sweet. We will have no regrets of Massachusetts.
Dear Professor Bayer, I've been wanting to write to you. So much has been happening here. My sister Meg is going to be having a baby. My sister Beth is very frail, but I know I have it in me to make her better. I decided to take her to Cape Cod, to Falmouth for a few days. Given all that is happening here, I don't know when I can return to New York. I miss it. I miss the volatile exchanges we had. I miss walks in the park to hear the speakers shout how they would change the world.
I too
would like to change the world.
Yes, of course. And how are you, sir?
She asks how I am, and so how am I. My days are my usual days. I wake up, I go out. Time goes by. My days are exactly the days I lived since arriving here. In fact, how I am is amazed how this comforts me year by year. I work and I eat, life is muffins and jam. The house is nice and quiet now. That is how I am. 5 years in these rooms, reading Hegel and Kant. My mind is devoted to thoughts on the meaning of life. What more could I want? So why is it lately I find I'm uneasy all through the night? And why even now does my skin feel explosive as dynamite? Why does my heart pound like a battering ram? How can she ask me how I am? How I am is fine. Dear Miss March, there's nothing dramatic or new to report. This will be short. Morning and evening, I live in my usual way. On a day you return, you will see for yourself. Tell me, Miss March, are you happy so far from the clanging beat of our turbulent street? Quite often I think of our days in New York. Though of course that you went, I have been quite content. Ah! I wake in the morning and all that I hear is the absence of sound. Yes! My peace is astir, but the ruckus is me as my thoughts run aground. I wanted a life by myself in these rooms, but now all around me another life loom. Who asked her to come and to go and to leave me like that? And now she expects me to send her a note with words by smoke it would sink to my throat. Who asked her to change how I live, how I think, how I am? I go through my daily routines, I give lessons, I wait, time goes by. Yet lately I find there's pleasure in humming a silly tune. And some days I go to the park and I sit there all afternoon. Some evenings I swear I can hear a door slam. The house is far too quiet now. That is how I am.
About New York.
It's a circus.
A circus?
Dancing clowns, waltzing camels. Sometimes you see them right out on the street. Museums and theaters everywhere. Oh, it's an amazing place, Beth. I'm going to take you there.
To New York?
And we'll dine in the best restaurants and see Shakespeare. And mingle with unsavory characters.
Joe, I have something for you. Marmee says the shell is over 1,000 years old. And I believe that once upon a time, it had an amazing life. And if you hold it to your ear, it talks to you.
What does it say?
It says, we grow up too fast. You're a woman of the world now. I am so proud of you, Joe.
When you were first born, about an hour old, I told Marmee.
Beth is mine.
Everyone has someone special in the world. And I have you, my sweet Beth. Give me a task to do.
Let's pretend we're riding on a kite. Let's imagine.
Say
tell you a secret?
Anything.
I never made plans about what I would do when I grew up. And I'm not afraid to die. The hardest part, Joe, is leaving you.
I won't let it happen. You'll get better. You will.
Some things are meant to be. The tide turning endlessly. The way it takes hold of me.
Everybody, I'm home.
Look at this house.
Marley, Joe.
We left it in shambles, and it's still in shambles.
Meg. Did you see the look I gave the coachman on March? His impertinence. He caught every bump in the road.
One should always be civil to a coachman, Amy. You must respect those who have the reins until you wrench the reins from them.
Yes, Aunt March. Joe. Marmy! When did this house get so small?
As we grow grand, Amy, the world around us often diminishes in size. I have known people who have almost disappeared before my very eyes.
You're such a dear, Aunt March. Thank you for everything.
I'll go see to that wretched coachman.
Remember, Aunt March, respect those who have the reins.
Very good.
Amy?
Meg! It's really you?
Marmy!
Let me look at you!
You're so beautiful!
You're a mother now. Twins, I can't believe it.
Neither can I.
Amy! Oh, my baby is home.
Look at her, Marmy!
You're all grown up.
I am. I really am. You can't imagine all the experiences I had. And everywhere I was, I'd think, if only Meg were here. If only Joe. Only Beth.
Amy.
I was so sorry I wasn't here to say goodbye to her. I cried for weeks. Aunt March said I was being unreasonable, but my heart was breaking not to be here with her.
Beth understood.
Joe!
Come here.
She said tell Amy not to fret.
Did she really say that?
Oh, she did. She was so brave, Amy. To the very end. You'd have been proud of her.
Come. Show us what you brought back.
It's a king's ransom. I have so much to tell you all. I ate frogs. Actual frogs. And how is John? Is he still romantic?
More so.
I knew it. Men are so amazing.
Lori.
It's almost everything.
I wasn't expecting you to come back, too.
Yes. We all sailed on the same ship.
You look different.
Do I? I'm taller. Didn't you so?
It was so so good of you to comfort Amy and Aunt Marge after our loss of Beth.
When I heard the news, I was devastated. I wanted to come see you. I thought of it.
Don't blame you, Lori. I was horrible to you. I was so unfeeling.
You said what you felt.
No. Guess what? I sold a story.
I knew it! I always had that sort of faith in you.
I know you did.
You know, you've changed too. Very distinguished.
Really? I missed you.
I missed you too. You know, I've learned something.
What's that?
I was never meant to fly on golden wings.
Who is?
You. You, Joe. You were meant to soar. Me, I was meant for more mundane things. I've decided to take up Grandfather's business. I know it's the last thing I would have thought for myself, but the truth is, I'm sort of fascinated by the prospects. I shall be wily and shrewd.
Lori, there you are.
Amy! Did you tell Joe?
Tell me what? The most amazing thing.
Really, quite a thing.
You tell her.
No, you tell her.
All right, I'll tell her. We were under the Bridge of Sighs.
In the gondola.
Under Italian skies.
She was singing lullabies.
He said he likes the way I sing.
The day was ours.
We talked for hours.
It was amazing.
I said I love fireflies.
I said so do I.
I told him I hate goodbyes.
There was something in her eyes.
I swear that bells began to ring.
We found that we
were so unlike.
It was amazing.
So tell me, who proposed who? Oh, you know! We were trying to be so discreet about it.
Amazing! There we were in Venice!
In a gondola!
In Venice!
When he suddenly stood up
and shouted,
"Will you marry me?" It was so romantic!
Then I fell into the water!
And before we even knew it,
she dove in and rescued me!
It happened before we knew.
How could we have known?
Amazing what time can do!
My heart flew.
We'll be married in the spring.
Whoever thought in all the world we'd fall in love, and yet we did.
It was amazing.
Amazing. Amazing. The most amazing thing.
Lori.
Oh.
Welcome to the family.
Thank you, Joe.
Joe, I'm so sorry. I never meant for it to happen like this. I'd always thought of Lori as yours.
He was never mine. He's always been one of us.
Joe, I want you to have this. It's a book of all my drawings. Everything you should have seen when I was in Europe, all the churches and palaces and mountains, I want you to have it.
Amy, I can't.
Yes, you can. We'll always be close, Joe, but we'll never change.
Never. Amy, thank you. Your drawings are beautiful.
Thank you.
Quebec used to be such a sanctuary for you. Whenever you were feeling sad or disappointed, you'd run up here, bolt the door, and come back hours later so full of life. I haven't seen that Joe in a while.
Can't write. Can't do anything, really. You were right. In the past, I could always come up with something. I was always so good at that. Beth would say Joe can make the clouds disappear. I want Beth back. I should have never broken her promise. I should have never gone to New York if I just stayed here.
Joe, stop it.
No one could have done more for Beth than you did. You could not have changed what happened.
How do you manage? How do you go on? Day in, day out, as if nothing has happened.
Do you think that's how I go on?
You're strong and wise. How can I be like you? How can I find that strength?
Don't make so much of me, Joe. I never dreamed of the sorrow. I never thought I'd have reason to lament. I'd hoped I'd never know heartbreak. How I wish I could change the way things went. I wanted nothing but goodness. I wanted reason to prevent. Not this bare emptiness. I wanted days of plenty. But I refuse to feel tragic. I am aching for more than pain and grief. There has got to be meaning. Most of all, when a life has been so brief, I have got to learn something. How can I give her any less? I want life to go on. I want days of plenty.
Promises we made would have a different end.
matter where or when. How can that be lost forever? How when I gave everything with all my heart? Several days before Christmas, sisters sat about the parlor and grumbled about their fate. Meg, the oldest and most romantic, said, "It's not fair that some girls have pretty things when we have nothing. It won't be Christmas without presents," said Amy, with her usual pout. "We haven't got Father to read to us," said Joe.
Dishes, 3 sets of silver, 4 cut glass bowls, 16 chairs, and all the flowers from my conservatory. I have joyfully been divested of all my worldly possessions.
Psst! Where's Amy?
You're not to see her before the wedding.
Come, Laurie, let's have a cigar before the ceremony begins. How do you feel? Ready to be a bridegroom?
My life has never been more complete. And the rain is held up.
Josephine!
I'll go find her.
And tell Amy I wish to talk to her about receiving line etiquette. We have the cream of Concord society arriving at any moment!
I understand you want to talk to me.
I suppose you realize this could have been your day.
You think I made a ghastly mistake?
I do not. Amy and Laurie are ideally suited to each other. I've gone over my will.
Aunt Marcia.
Meg will inherit most of my money,
Amy is making her way into society and won't need any of it. And as for you, I know you don't want anything, and yet you want everything. Josephine, every girl, every woman needs something to fall back on when times are bleak. I'm leaving you my house.
Your house?
Do something worthwhile of it. Make a library or a school.
That's very generous of you. Thank you, Aunt March.
I don't like that dress.
It was one of your old ones.
Well, it looked better on me.
Joe, there's a strange man at the front gate asking for you. Should I let him in?
Professor Bayer?
Hello.
Hello. This is a surprise.
You wrote if I should ever come north, I should visit you.
Yes, but I never thought...
You never thought I would do it. Well, I did. I'm here. Should I go?
No.
I'm not intruding?
You're not intruding. Come, I'll introduce you to...
No, not yet. I brought back your manuscript. It was so good of you to send me your book.
There's no one whose opinion I respect more than yours. Forgive me for...
It touched me deeply. I saw you on every page. I heard your voice. I felt your spirit. It was magnificent.
Joe, Amy is driving me insane. Now she's talking about changing her veil. Oh, excuse me.
This is my sister Meg. This is Professor Bayer.
Yes, I recognize you from your sister's book.
So you're the one she's let read it.
I'll be right there.
I've come at a bad time.
No, it's just a wedding.
A wedding?
I often think about you, Professor. I wonder how you are doing.
I bought a kite.
You bought a kite?
I've never had a kite before. You know, you were right to think I was old. I was.
No,
I was, but since we met, everything's different. Everyone's noticed. My students, even. They say, Professor, you're smiling today. Miss March.
Joe,
we are not at all alike. We have our differences. May I be blunt?
Be blunt, by all means.
If I say rain, then you say sun. If I say rain, then you say sun. If I say yes, then you say no. It seems before we start, we're done. We even argue at hello. If I say share with me this small umbrella.
I say who cares if I get wet?
We are as different as the morning and the night.
No, we're as different as the winter and the spring.
We always seem to fight.
We disagree on everything.
And yet, you'll make me smile, you'll make me laugh, you'll make me care. How can I explain inside my heart I feel left when you're not there? That one small thing in common, love could be like a small umbrella in the rain.
Josephine!
Christopher Columbus!
The guests will be arriving soon, and I want the family gathered in the parlor. And who is this man?
This is Professor Bayer.
Call me Fritz.
Fritz? Is that your name, Fritz?
Did I not tell you?
No.
Saying, Fritz.
When people discover passion, they've come across something rare. This fervor they have in common will shelter them anywhere. Though the rest may be proud with such passion to share, I think we have more than enough to make a marriage. If we dare.
You are proposing?
No,
Yes, yes, I do not meet today, or tomorrow, or in a month, a year, 2 years even. I'm a patient man.
I won't be sweet, won't be demure.
This I prefer, this I adore.
I'll speak my mind, you can be sure.
I'll be enchanted to the core.
If I say, let me share your small umbrella.
I'll say, who cares if we get wet? As different as a woman and a man.
Fight our way through life.
We'll disagree the best we can.
And yet,
you'll make me smile, you'll make me laugh, you'll make me care. How can I explain inside my heart I feel a pain when you're not there?
Horrid man, Dashwood, stubborn, blunt to a fault.
What did he say?
He said, it's a bit long. He misses the blood and guts. He likes the four sisters, particularly the outspoken one. He wants to publish it.
He said that?
If it's all right with you.
Oh,
Joe, we need you inside.
Marmee, I want you to meet a good friend of mine, Professor Fritz Bayer. He's come to stay with us. We're thinking of starting the school together.
A school?
Not today, or next week, but someday.
Welcome, Professor. Come inside and meet our family.
Sometimes when you dream, your dreams come true in extraordinary ways. Suddenly a day be so amazing. And sometimes when you yearn, you burn the air, and then you are not the same, and the world is...
Joe, we're all waiting for you.